Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Brian Shapiro, a market segment manager at ATCC. Thank you for joining us for the latest installments in the ATCC Excellence in Research webinar series. It's entitled Navigating the HCMI Searchable Catalog and Accessing HCMI Data at NCI's Genomic Data Commons, presented by Drs. Eva Thompson-Carter, Bill Wysocki, and James Clinton. If you have any questions for our speakers, please use the chat function available through the webinar program. All questions will be answered as time allows at the end of the presentation. The recorded webinar presentation will be archived on the ATCC website, www.atcc.org. Before we get started, just a couple words about ATCC. Founded in 1925, ATCC is a nonprofit organization with headquarters in Manassas, Virginia, and an R&D and services center in Gaithersburg, Maryland. We are the world's largest, most diverse biological materials and information resource for cell culture. We're considered the gold standard. We're also an innovative R&D company featuring gene editing, differentiated stem cells, and advanced models such as the HCMI models that will be discussed today. So with that, I'd like to welcome Dr. James Clinton.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. My name is James Clinton. I am a lead scientist at ATCC. Over the past several years, ATCC has made hundreds of novel human patient-derived cancer models available to the research community as part of our ongoing collaboration with the National Cancer Institute's Human Cancer Models Initiative. This is a growing collection of in vitro cancer models, and so far represents cancers from 26 primary tissues, a variety of model types, including 3D organoids and neurospheres, and the models are associated with a wealth of molecular characterizations and clinical annotation. I'm pleased to introduce our guest speakers who will be delving into some available online resources to help you better explore this collection of cancer models and how to access the associated patient and sequencing data. Our first speaker is Dr. Eva Thompson-Carter, Scientific Program Manager at NCI Center for Cancer Genomics, who will be talking more about the objectives of the Human Cancer Model Initiative, as well as a walkthrough of the HCMI Searchable Catalog, an online platform dedicated to the HCMI models. And our second speaker is Dr. Bill Wysocki, Lead for User and Data Services at the Genomic Data Commons and the Center for Translation Data Science at the University of Chicago, who will be talking about accessing the HCMI-specific biospecimen and sequencing data at the GDC, a repository for large cancer datasets. With that, I'm going to turn the presentation over to Dr. Thompson-Carter.
Thank you, James. Good afternoon. Today, I will discuss the Human Cancer Models Initiative, HCMI program, and its resources. The Human Cancer Models Initiative, or HCMI program, is an international consortium that was established by the National Cancer Institute, Cancer Research UK, and Wellcome Sanger Institute in the United Kingdom, and Hubrecht Organoid Technology in the Netherlands. The goal of the HCMI program is to provide models that are derived from a wide range of tumor types that are broadly available to the scientific community and that are associated with clinical, biospecimen, and molecular characterization data. The NCI-supported cancer model development pipeline contains several components. The tissues are collected and used for model development. A portion of the originating tumor-derived model and normal are processed to isolate nucleic acids for molecular characterization. Clinical data are collected at two time points, including enrollment and follow-up, which is at least 3 months after enrollment. Cancer-specific case report forms are used to collect clinical data, and data are quality checked and mapped to NCI's Genomic Data Commons, or GDC, data dictionary. The molecular characterization includes RNA-seq, 15x whole genome sequencing, 150x whole exome sequencing, and methylation characterization. The clinical, biospecimen, and molecular characterization data are stored and harmonized at NCI's GDC and are made available to the research community, which Bill will go over in more detail later in the presentation. These models are distributed worldwide through a single third-party distributor, ATCC, and interested researchers can search and identify available models in the HCMI Searchable Catalog, which I'll discuss in a few slides. The HCMI resources include the HCMI Searchable Catalog, cancer-specific case report forms, informed consent template, as well as links to ATCC and the clinical biospecimen and molecular characterization data at the GDC. The cancer-specific case report forms are organized by enrollment and follow-up forms. For example, an enrollment form is shown to the right. The case report forms utilize controlled vocabulary that are registered in NCI's Cancer Data Standards Registry and Repository to ensure data interoperability, as well as harmonized with GDC's data dictionary so that the data are indexed and searchable at the GDC. Now I'll give a brief overview of the HCMI Searchable Catalog and its functionalities. The HCMI Searchable Catalog was developed to provide a public-facing online catalog to query and identify HCMI next-generation cancer models available to the research community. The HCMI Searchable Catalog contains model data from all consortium members, and the data types include model information, a subset of the collected clinical data, distributor information, and molecular characterization data. The Searchable Catalog is updated as the data become available. The landing page contains the list of all available models within the Searchable Catalog, and currently there are 295 available models. The left-hand side of the catalog contains the searchable data elements for you to identify models of interest. The main viewing table contains the list of available models and is dynamic. As you select data of interest, the model list will update accordingly. You can filter the models by a data of interest, including primary site, age at diagnosis, as well as by gene, specific somatic variants, and types of mutations, as available open access masked somatic MAF data generated at the GDC has been integrated into the searchable catalog. The graphs at the top of the page are also interactive and can be used as part of your search. Within the main viewing table, you can sort the models by the data columns shown, including clinical diagnosis, primary site, age at diagnosis, and more. Next, I'll go over a simple search within the catalog. The filter panel on the left-hand side of the page can be used to select data of interest. For example, if colon is chosen as the primary site of interest, which also has a KRAS mutation, the filtered list goes from 295 to 13 models. The graphics at the top of the page are also dynamic as data are filtered, as you can see that the primary site graph now just shows one site. You can also select which data are shown for the models listed in the main viewing table by the call-ups drop-down menu, where you can select or deselect data as needed. The search results can be exported for use at a later date by selecting the export button. Additionally, you can select models from the main viewing table by checking the box next to the model name, and these models can be stored in the My Models list located at the right-hand side of the page. This feature is particularly helpful if you carry out multiple searches and identify several models of interest. The model list and their associated data can be downloaded from within the My Models list. Individual model pages can be viewed by selecting any model name from the main viewing table. For example, let's select HCM-CSHL-0247-C18-A. Data on the individual model page includes model details. There are some cases where multiple models were generated from the same patient, such as primary metastasis or multiple metastases. For this model, it was generated from a primary tumor, and the second model was generated from a metastasis. These multiple models are linked within the searchable catalog. The molecular characterization data types that are currently available at GDC for this case can be viewed. A subset of the open access clinical data are shown, and the full clinical data can be accessed at the GDC. Additionally, there are images of the models and culture, as well as licensing information. At the bottom of the page, the available open access masked somatic math model data created at GDC are integrated into the HCMI Searchable Catalog. You can search and sort the masked somatic math data as well as download. Since the original search was for models from colon and have a KRAS variant, you can filter the gene list in the search box and identify the KRAS variant. The open access masked somatic maps are highly processed to remove lower quality and potential germline variants. If omission of true positive somatic mutations is a concern, we do recommend accessing the controlled access maps, which requires DBGAP certification. Controlled access data will be reviewed by Bill later in today's presentation. Additionally, the available clinical sequencing and histopathological biomarkers are listed. If we look at the clinical sequencing tab, you can see the same KRAS variant was identified. Within the external resources section, there are links to the model distributor, ATCC, where you can obtain the models and reagents, protocols, and images of the models and culture. Of the 295 models in the searchable catalog, data for 240 models are available at the GDC, with additional cases planned for upcoming GDC data releases. To see the data for this model at the GDC, you can click the case metadata button within the external resources section. On the GDC case page, you can view the available case-associated data of interest, including the clinical, biospecimen, and sequencing data. There is a summary table of the file counts by data category or by experimental strategy. When you scroll down the page, a summary of the clinical data can be viewed and downloaded. Clicking through the clinical data tabs, you can view the treatment information for this patient. Scrolling further down the page, you can view the available biospecimen data as well as download this data. To conclude my part of the presentation, the HCMI cancer model development pipeline is comprised of many collaborators, and all their effort results in high quality next generation cancer models and accompanying data for the research community. Next, Bill Wysocki will walk through navigating the GDC.
All right, thank you, Eva, and good afternoon, everyone. My name is Bill, and today I'd like to talk to you about the HCMI data in the Genomic Data Commons, or GDC. Just to go over a little bit of an agenda for what we're going to talk about today, first I'd like to give a brief introduction to the GDC, followed by an introduction to the data that is available for HCMI. After that will be a walkthrough on how to download HCMI data from the GDC. And lastly, we will talk about controlled data access, how that can be provided, and why data is open or controlled. So starting with an introduction to the GDC, the GDC is a data repository for cancer genomics. This includes molecular data, biospecimen data, and clinical data. The general flow for the GDC is that submitted data is processed using a set of standardized pipelines, and that resulting data is stored in a flexible data model. This data is eventually released to the wider research community through the GDC data portal, which we will talk about a little bit later in this presentation. To go over the three main aspects of the GDC data, the first and largest one is the molecular data. This includes data from multiple experimental strategies, and the harmonized data starts at the alignment and includes downstream derived data. This includes the experimental strategies such as whole exome sequencing, whole genome sequencing, RNA-seq, and methylation. With molecular data, most researchers will need to know about the patients. This is why we have clinical data. This is uploaded as metadata associated with the cases or patients. In the GDC, we call them cases. And this data is also available as supplement files. The biospecimen data is also, like clinical data, uploaded as metadata. It is associated with samples, portions, analytes, and aliquots. This data is also available in supplement format. As of now, the HCMI data in the GDC includes 228 subjects, over 103 terabytes across almost 15,000 data files, and over 74,000 explorable somatic mutations. So the different experimental strategies that are available for HCMI in the GDC will be overviewed now. The first one are the alignments. One of the main parts of GDC harmonization is aligning all files to the same reference genome. For all next-generation sequencing strategies, alignments are available in BAM format, and this is a general overview of how that is done. This flowchart is for the whole exome sequencing strategy. Generally, this is used to call somatic variants using several different pipelines, and these variants are available as VCFs or MAFs and in raw or filtered format. The whole genome sequencing strategy is also mainly composed of somatic variants, but this also includes indels, copy number, and structural variants. The RNA-seq data, in addition to alignment, is available as gene expression values, which are read counts per gene and normalized using several different methods. And transcript fusion and splice junction files are also available in the RNA-seq strategy. The methylation array data is different from the others since it is not next-generation sequencing, but the raw array files are available with the germline probes removed, and the methylation beta values are available as well. Following that data introduction, I'm going to go through a walkthrough on how to download HCMI data from GDC. This particular use case is downloading RNA-seq gene expression data. So this is the HCMI case page that Eva left off on during her introduction. I'd like to bring your attention to several panels here. One is the file counts by data category at the bottom left. The other are the file counts for the experimental strategy at the bottom right. And at the top right is the option to add all of the files to your cart for this particular case. Because our use case is downloading gene expression data, this is performed with RNA-seq, and zooming in here, you would click on this link here, the number 28, which will bring you to a list of the 28 RNA-seq files. Before we actually follow that link, I'd like to show you one of the features of the case page, which is how to check for biospecimen entities. So at the top in the field, I've typed RNA, and as you can see, we have four analytes that have showed up. This corresponds to the two tumor samples, one which is primary tumor and one that is a metastasis, and the two that come from the model samples. So this comes down to four RNA-seq samples in total. So going back and following that link from the original case page, this brings us to the repository view. These are all of the files associated with that particular case. As you can see on the left here, the RNA-seq experimental strategy is already selected. At the top, we have a summary of the entire query, which, as expected, is for one specific case, which is referred to by its unique identifier. And the experimental strategy is RNA-seq because we clicked on the RNA-seq row. At the top of the table here, we have the number of files associated with this case and the number of cases that are associated with this group of files. Because of this use case, of course, it's going to be one because we've only asked for the files associated with one case. Expanding some of the other filters, we have the option to filter this down a little bit more because our use case is to download gene expression files. And we don't want things like the original molecular files, the original BAM files, or some of these downstream controlled access files. Everything we're going to download is going to be open access. We're going to talk about how to access controlled data a bit later. So to get the open access gene expression quantification files, we're going to filter on the left for data type is gene expression quantification. And this is an open access type of data. So as you can see at the column here on the right, all of these files are open. In addition, when you filter for one attribute, the other options for other attributes, in this case, workflow type, are filtered down to only those that exist within the first attribute. So when gene expression quantification is selected, only the stars count workflow is now available because that is the only workflow that is available for gene expression quantification. So now that we have our four files here, our next step is to start downloading them. To kick this off, what we'll want to do is click on the Add Files to Cart button in the center of the screen that's highlighted here. As you can see on the left, we have four files. And when we add them, four files are now added to the cart on the top right. Going to the cart, this gives a summary of the files that are about to be downloaded. I'd like to bring your attention to the panel on the left, which has a summary of the number of files, cases, and the file size of all the files included in the cart at this time. On the top right, we have the file counts by authorization level. As you can see, all four files are authorized because they are open access. If there were some controlled access data here, they would show up as unauthorized and would require you to log in with the correct dbGaP credentials. On the bottom here is a series of buttons that will allow you to download these specific files and additionally download metadata about these files too. All the way on the right here is the option to download the actual files. This can be done by clicking on the download button and then clicking on cart. To the left of the download button are more buttons that have more information about the files in the cart. So to the left, we have the biospecimen and clinical buttons, which of course download the biospecimen and clinical data. When clicking on them, you have the option to download them in TSV or JSON format, depending on your preference. The sample sheet downloads the basic metadata in a TSV format. This includes the case and sample that each file is associated with. The metadata button downloads all possible metadata in JSON format. This is everything in the GDC associated with these particular files. When you download the actual files, the file will download as a tar.gz file. This means it's bundled and zipped. If you're using macOS, these files will be opened automatically upon download. If you're using Windows, it will usually require another program. Two of the most common ones are WinRAR and 7-Zip. when the cart is downloaded and they are in a bundle, each file will be in a folder named after its UUID. As you can see on the bottom right here, we have GDC underscore download, which is our initial bundle of files. We below that, one level down, is a folder named after a UUID. This UUID corresponds to the file UUID that this file below, one more level down, is identified by. That means that if there's multiple files, they will all be unique in their parent folder. Each of these bundles will also contain a manifest and any annotations associated with the files, which may contain additional information about the subjects, samples, or anything else downloaders might need to know. I'm not going to go over them today, but I'd like to point out two additional download methods. There's the data transfer tool, which can be used to download much larger files via the command line, and the GDC API if you have more development skills and would like a more customized GDC experience. A reminder I'd like to give everyone is that download of controlled access files requires dbgap access and login through the GDC data portal. That brings me into the next section, which is on controlled access data. So next I'm going to talk about why data in the GDC may be controlled. Files in the GDC are either open or controlled access. Controlled files usually contain identifiable information, such as genomic sequence. As you can see on the controlled column there, all of the strategies that are next generation sequencing have the BAM file included. This is because it actually contains genomic sequence, and that could identify a particular subject. This also contains information that is more derived, such as VCFs or MAFs, which may have information that you could use to identify a person. The open files are usually more derived and has much less identifiable information. For example, if you were downloading RNA-seq data, and this was gene expression, this would only give you information about how much a gene was expressed and nothing about the actual sequence of that gene. This could not be used to identify a person and therefore is open access. In addition, the GDC only accepts clinical and biospecimen data that is open access. So any clinical and biospecimen data that is available through the API will be open access. There are some exceptions though for clinical and biospecimen supplements. Now I'd like to go over how to obtain access to control data in the GDC. The first step is to obtain an ERA Commons account. This requires information about the users, their research, and their institution. The specific information is run through by the ERA group. So when you go to apply for it, they will tell you exactly what you need. If you are working with an academic institution, many of them have specific people or departments who can definitely help navigate the ERA application process. This is something that research universities do a lot. The next step is to obtain dbgap access to a particular project. So the ERA Commons ID is the first step because that is what you need to log in to dbgap. The PI of your group will log into dbgap and create a dbgap project based on your research project. This will require information about your project and the specific data sets that you need. So these data sets are added to the project during registration, and the data sets are specified by their PHS number. This is an identifier for a particular data set in dbgap, and for HCMI, the number is PHS001486. This will give you access to HCMI data in the GDC. One thing I'd like to point out is that each data set has its own policies, and these are outlined when you add these data sets to your dbGaP project. So each data set will have rules that you will need to read through and acknowledge that you agree to. So once PI access to the data set is approved, they can provide access to team members within their lab. Usually this applies to academics labs in which you have the PI who leads the lab and they grant access to members of their lab, like graduate students or potentially postdocs. We know that there are lots of relationships within the academic research. So if you have any uncertainties about who can gain access under a particular PI, we recommend contacting dbGaP. Team members must also have ERA Commons to be granted access. So everyone will need their own ERA Common ID. And one thing I like to tell anyone who is granting dbGaP access is that they need to log in to dbGaP at least once for you to see them to grant them access. Once the correct people have access, you will log into the GDC data portal using the ERA Commons ID. You would do this by going to the top right of the portal, clicking on the login button, and that will bring up an NIH login for which you will put your ERA Commons ID and credentials. Once you do that, instead of login, you will see your ERA Commons ID. So it'll look like your name. And that means you are logged in. The permissions from dbGaP that you have will be applied automatically. You will have access to any controlled data set you are approved for through dbGaP. So GDC will have this information. The other options after logging in are the user profile, which will show you which project your account has access to, and the download token, which downloads a token that carries your credentials. So this can be used to download GDC data through either the API or the data transfer tool. And this specifically applies to control data. At the very end of this part of the presentation, I'd like to show you a few useful links. The GDC portal can be accessed at portal.gdc.cancer.gov. The documentation site is also available at docs.gdc.cancer.gov and has user's guides for all of the GDC products. So if you're interested in anything the GDC has to offer, this documentation site will have the information you need. The GDC website has more high-level information about the GDC at gdc.cancer.gov. And I'd like to plug the GDC help desk. This is a help desk that my team manages at support@nci-gdc.datacommons.io. You can find this email address by going to the support tab at gdc.cancer.gov. And in addition to having the help desk email, you also have a link to our monthly support webinars and their recordings, and a link to join the GDC user listserv, which is a mailing list that will give information about upcoming updates to the GDC and any release that goes out will be announced there. I'd like to thank everyone for your attention, and I will hand the presentation back to James. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Wysocki. I'd like to take this opportunity to ask the research community for help in prioritizing the development and release of additional HCMI models. While hundreds are already available, there are models that have still not entered our manufacturing pipeline. On the ATCC website, you can browse and search the list of these unreleased HCMI models. This list is grouped by primary tissue site and shows the model type, disease, and links out to the HCMI Searchable Catalog, which you heard about earlier, for additional model-specific information. The HCMI Searchable Catalog itself also has a toggle that includes the ability to show or hide unreleased models, allowing for advanced searching and filtering based on model-specific criteria. Once you've identified a model or models of interest, you can submit that information to ATCC either via the form on the ATCC website at atcc.org/hcmi-input or via email to hcmi@atcc.org. We will use that information to guide our production pipeline. I'd like to thank you all for your time and attention. And with that, I'm going to hand things back to Brian.
Well, thank you, Ava, Bill, and James for the excellent presentation. In just a few moments, we will begin our Q&A session. Please use the chat function available through the webinar program to submit your question. The recorded webinar presentation will be available on demand on the ATCC website at www.atcc.org. We've already had a bunch of questions come in, so let's go ahead and jump in. So this first question, my organization requires signed informed consent documents to work with patient-derived cells. Are those available for the HCMI model?
Thanks, Brian. I can take that. The signed informed consent documents are not available for distribution. They are kept by the study PI at the consenting institution.
All right. Good, good. And can the HCMI models be tracked back to a specific donor?
So the
HCMI IDs, which are the barcode looking ones that start with HCM dash and then a bunch of codes, they are anonymized and they cannot be used to identify specific subjects. Access to controlled access data and any data that's used in GDC requires users to certify that they will not attempt to identify specific subjects.
All right, good, good. Now here's an interesting question. Why are there sometimes differences between the somatic mutation data shown at the MCI SC and what I found at the GDC?
Sure, I can take that. The somatic mutations that are shown on the HCMI searchable catalog show the data from the derived model that was used for molecular characterization by the HCMI program. The default somatic mutations that are shown at the GDC are for the tumor when they're available from which the model was derived. So there could be differences there between those data.
All righty. So now this next question is actually around access. So are commercial organizations not performing basic research eligible for DBGAP access?
Sure, I can take that one. So first of all, when you apply for DBGAP access to a specific project, they will have you sign a specific agreement that gives the specific rules about using that data set. However, we at this webinar aren't exactly experts on what those are. We would recommend going through that and also reaching out to the DBGAP team, who, if you go to the DBGAP website, you can see that they have a help desk and they can help you out with that.
All right, good, good. Okay, why are some models missing molecular characterization? Which would be like red X's seen in the HCMI searchable catalog, I guess.
Sure. So some data were not able to be generated due to insufficient nucleic acids or because a biospecimen was unavailable, for example, the originating tumor, or in a very small number of cases, normal was missing.
All righty. Now,
how can I translate UUIDs back to a specific HCMI case, or I guess ID3?
So UUIDs, depending on which one you're using, all can be translated back to a specific HCMI case. So on the GDC case summary page that we've shown in this webinar, you can see that the case ID and the HCMI barcode, the ID3, are shown there. In addition, if you're looking at files and their specific UUIDs, those can be mapped to specific HCMI cases by putting them in your cart and clicking on the button that's titled sample sheet. This will give you lots of information about your files and how they relate to specific cases, and it's available in PSV format, so it can be viewed on Excel or any sort of spreadsheet program.
All righty. Now, are there any tools available to better work with case metadata and sequencing files?
Sure, I'll take that. Currently, there's no scientific consensus on the gold standard for working with sequencing files. Each scientist is responsible for evaluating and choosing the pipeline that they'll use to work on with the sequencing data.
All righty. And can either of you comment on what's the frequency threshold used to remove low-frequency variants to generate the mass somatic MAF?
Yeah, that's a good question. So the GDC has a very rigorous pipeline for removing any variants that could possibly be germline in the mass somatic map, and this is so that can be open access. I won't get into the exact details here because there's a lot of steps there, but if you'd like to see the pipeline that is actually used here, I'd recommend going to the documentation website, which was listed in the webinar, but it's at docs.gdc.cancer.gov. And then in the data section, there is a portion on DNA-seq, and that has all of the details of the GDC DNA-seq pipeline.
All righty, good. Now, is a customer allowed to resequence the HCMI model?
Yeah, there are no prohibitions on in place regarding resequencing.
Alrighty. Here's kind of a follow-up question around sequencing data. Why do some of the models not have any sequencing data at all in the HCMI searchable catalog or the genomic data commons? And could you comment on what other filtering might be performed?
Yeah,
sure.
At the GDC, the HCMI molecular data is released as data completes the GDC harmonization pipeline, so some of it may not be done. Also, I want to mention that GDC data is released periodically. We try to be once every 2 months. Sometimes it's a bit different than that. And specific data releases are released. So all data at the same time comes out in one data release. If you're wondering when a data release is coming out or when one does come out, you can sign up for the GDC listserv, which was mentioned during the webinar. And this will let you know anytime there's a new data release, as well as anything important like maintenance windows or data information that needs to be known to the wider community.
All right. And can you comment on when, like, new models are made available at ATCC?
Hey, Brian, I'll take this one.
Okay.
So ATCC does not have a specific timeline for release of any particular model.
It's a multi-stage process that involves both ATCC and quality control tech tests being done by the HCMI consortium itself. I would encourage you or any end user that's interested in a particular model to contact us either via the webpage that we have, and we had a slide on that talks about that I talked about, where you can provide feedback indicating that you're interested in the model, and then we can maybe give you feedback that way, or by emailing us directly at the HCMI@ATCC.org website.
All right, thanks, James. All right, and can anyone comment, when will the Genomic Data Commons have data for, you know, any new models?
Yeah, basically the same answer as before. The data does need to go through the pipeline at the harmonization pipelines at the GDC, and then they need to be included in a data release. So we would recommend signing up for the GDC listserv if you want to be informed when those happen.
Okay. And does the HCMI have patient-matched normal tissue models? That might be a good one for James.
James. At this time, the patient-matched normal tissue models are not available for HCMI.
All right. This is the last question that we've had come in so far, so we'll do this as last call. If you have any questions, please submit them now. What QC measures are taken by the HCMI to ensure the models are representative of the originating tumor? And then kind of as a follow-up question, do the HCMI models have the exact same mutations as the patient's tumor?
Thanks, Brian. I can take that. NCI conducts an initial quality check to determine if the derived model and the tumor have a similar mutational profile. Work is ongoing in the analysis working group to complete a comprehensive analysis of the HCMI models and their associated data, and for these results to be published in the near future. It has been our experience, though, that the HCMI models and tumors have similar mutational profiles. However, it's not unexpected for some differences to exist due to the heterogeneous natures of cancers, tumors, and the culture process. Some of the ATCC expanded HCMI models have been resequenced and have shown to be similar to the originating model sequenced by the HCMI program. These data are also available at the Genomic Data Commons as they complete the analysis pipeline and are released in the data portal.
All right. Well, we haven't had any further questions come in, so we can conclude our Q&A session. I'd really like to thank our speakers for the excellent presentation, and thank you everyone for attending the webinar. For more information, you can navigate to either ATCC's HCMI page at www.atcc.org/HCMI, the HCMI Searchable Catalog, link is hcmisearchablecatalog.nci.nih.gov, or the HCMI GDC Data Portal, or portal.gdc.cancer.gov. Thank you again, everyone, for attending this webinar, and have a great day.